What if you could track an athlete's fitness without really putting them through a test? Hi, I'm Jo Clubb, founder and sports science consultant at Global Performance Insights. And in this video, we're going to look into submaximal fitness testing, a really quick and simple practical way to track our athlete's fitness over time. And a new feature just released with Firstbeat Sports helps you to very quickly and easily analyze your team's submaximal fitness testing. So make sure you watch to the end to get some insights into this great new feature on their software. So we're well aware that in team sports today, maximal fitness testing is few and far between. It places a great burden on our athletes, clearly adds fatigue and neuromuscular load onto them, and often, practically speaking, is difficult for us given the need for specialist equipment or perhaps lab-based sessions. Trying to squeeze this into our tight schedules and fixture congestions makes it near on impossible, and certainly in season. And that is why submaximal fitness testing has really gained popularity in recent times. These are standardized, moderate intensity efforts that can be easily embedded into the training, potentially even into the warm-up. They're quick, non-fatiguing, very practical, even for large groups. And by utilizing a fixed external load, that allows us to look at the internal load, so the heart rate response to that fixed load, and track that over time for our athletes, enabling a simple assessment of their aerobic fitness. So two key papers from Zil Shushan in sports medicine provide a really comprehensive overview of the literature, and I'll put a link below to an article on my blog where you can access all these papers and the references as well. So in one of these review papers, Shushan and his colleagues identified over 100 different published submaximal fitness testing protocols, and they were able to organize it into this taxonomy that identify five distinct submaximal fitness test protocols characterized by their combination of exercise regimen in terms of whether it was a continuous or an intermittent test, as well as then the progression of exercise intensity, whether it was fixed, incremental, or variable. They also looked into the various outcome measures that were used as part of all these different submaximal fitness testing protocols. And two of the most common ones were heart rate based. So they were the heart rate during the exercise, which is typically measured in the last 60 seconds of the test, as well as then the heart rate recovery. So the drop in the beats per minute after exercise, say at a fixed time, perhaps 1 minute after the end of the test. As we'll see later, the new Firstbeat Sports report enables you to automatically capture both of these heart rate indices across all your athletes who have conducted the test. So if you're looking now to implement a submaximal fitness test for the first time and not sure what protocol to use, in one of the papers, Shushan and his colleagues put together this recommended protocol whereby the exercise regimen uses a continuous approach. So either longer shuttles, a figure of eight course, or more of a rectangle or track approach, because when we're adding in more change of direction, then that adds to the neuromuscular load. They recommend this moderate constant intensity, somewhere between 12 to 14 kilometers per hour, depending on your population, the age, the level, the sport, just to get this moderate exercise intensity that should elicit approximately 75 to 85% of an individual's maximum heart rate throughout the test. They recommend conducting this constant fixed intensity around the course for somewhere between 3 or perhaps 4 minutes in length, and then using as the outcome measure that mean heart rate exercise during either perhaps the last 30 seconds or the last 60 seconds of the test. And an important note there is to be able to inspect the heart rate trace for potential errors or outliers, and that is something we will come back to shortly as well. And we have finally some other important considerations here for the implementation. I'm really emphasizing this standardized approach keeps it consistent. So always conducting it in the same point within the microcycle, whether that's 2 days before a match or 2 days after a match, for instance, and trying to keep the surface, the environment, and just those conditions of the test as consistent as possible within the practicalities of the team sport environment. This approach then links to that concept of invisible monitoring that I've spoken about previously, it's not necessarily testing the athletes without them knowing, but it's more about this reduction of testing burden on them, whereby we can use data we're already collecting without adding additional tests. In this case, we can integrate this kind of submaximal fitness test pretty easily into a team on-field warm-up. We can probably conduct it weekly if we want to. So because that external load is fixed, as long as we conduct it consistently every time, then we can use the heart rate response to interpret an athlete's fitness status. For instance, if their heart rate at the end of the test, so heart rate exercise, reduces over time, then that is an indication that their aerobic fitness is improving. And it could be a really useful tool to use, particularly in the pre-season period or when an athlete is returning from injury. Conversely, if we start to see with an individual increase in their heart rate exercise in response to this fixed external load, or perhaps change in their heart rate recovery where the drop is not so great, this could be a quick flag that there's something more going on. Perhaps they're detraining in terms of their fitness, or it could be something to do with their fatigue status. So it's just a quick, easy flag to perhaps investigate further for that athlete. So by using this multivariate approach of combining internal and external load through an invisible monitoring fashion, then we can get more insight into our athlete status without any extra effort, extra fatigue, or extra burden of testing. Now, while this approach reduces the burden on the athletes, one of the issues perhaps has been that it can increase the burden on the practitioner of having to go through every individual athlete, calculate the heart rate at the end of the test, calculate the heart rate recovery. And that's why the new fitness testing feature in Firstbeat Sports is so exciting, because it really simplifies this process for us practitioners. It allows us to define the protocol that we're using, which, as I pointed out earlier, is really important because there are so many different approaches. So we can enter in our standardized protocol and whether we then want to include that heart rate recovery as an additional metric. Once that is input into the system, then we simply select the athletes. We define the start time of the test using the heart rate trace itself. And we can either do this in bulk if everyone did it at the same time, or individually if there were differences when athletes started the test, and then the rest is done for you. It automatically calculates then the peak 60-second average heart rate, as well as the heart rate recovery and over the time that you specified for your protocol. So you'll see the results from the current test. You'll also see a comparison of that for each individual athlete to their previous test. And then we can also visualize for each athlete their results over time and compare to baselines with Z-scores or percentage change points. So this is really simplifying and automating the analysis process for us when it comes to submaximal fitness testing. And let's dive quickly then into the example report from Firstbeat. We can see at the top here, then we get a team summary, where for each individual, we see here the peak percentage heart rate over that 60-second period, along with their heart rate recovery. And as well as seeing the absolute result for each individual, we see a percentage change from previous for each athlete. We then have our comparison chart, which shows the heart rate trace for each individual in our group. And as mentioned earlier in Shushan's research, it's really important to visually inspect the heart rate traces as well for outliers or errors. And we can therefore then remove that individual's athlete so not as to affect the data longitudinally. And then we get a more in-depth athlete testing view where we can see their results and how they differ from their previous data in more detail. So we can toggle here between the absolute difference, but also then use a Z-score, which is a great tool for comparing an individual to a range of data collected in a test. So if you're not comfortable with what a Z-score is, then definitely have a look at my video explaining that in more detail, because it's really useful in sports science. So clearly with this view, we get a great deal of insight into trends over time. But of course, most crucially of all, this was simplified and automated thanks to Firstbeat. Without us having to go through each individual athlete manually, we get this great summary at the click of a button after we have downloaded the data from that session. In summary then, Submax fitness testing is a really simple, practical, but powerful way for us to track our athletes over time without the need for additional testing. And thanks to Firstbeat Sports' new fitness testing feature, the analysis of this now can be much more automated and insightful. I'll put a link below then to Firstbeat Sports' website so you can go and take a look at some of their other resources they have on this topic and reach out to them if you want to discuss more. I'll also link to my Global Performance Insights blog where you can see more resources and references on this topic, as well as all the sports science resources I've spoken about. And I hope you found this video useful. If you did, please like and subscribe so you don't miss out on another Sports Science Insights video coming very soon.